Hi, I will be presenting our paper on code replicability in computer graphics. We had three main motivations for our paper. First, when we do research, we need to compare our method to others. And how can we do that if the code for other methods is not available? Are we supposed to re-implement everything and spend months doing that? Also, we are doing research and science, and often we try to improve over other methods. And again, how can we do that if no code is available? And finally, how can I trust others' results if no code is available? Maybe they have photoshopped their results? So even without going in this direction, maybe they just have a bug. And if my re-implementation produces different results, how can I be sure whether I have a bug or whether the authors had a bug? And there are famous examples of bugs. For example, in genomic, we know that Excel is converting dates, and the gene SEPT2, for example, its code name is SEPT2, that is converted to 2nd of September. And this messes up with further analysis and produced errors in papers. There is a famous bug in a popular fMRI software as well that increased the false positive rates and that also impacted many papers and published results. So we have three main goals as well, which is to evaluate the replicability of code in computer graphics. And here, just to be clear, we will be using the ACM definition of replicability, which is based on using the author's code, as opposed to the reproducibility, which implies re-implementing everything. And this definition is highly debated. There is a more consensual, maybe, definition that is opposite to this one, that is used, for example, by the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine. We will be basing our analysis on SIGGRAPH 2014, 16, and 18 as a proxy of a conference with high-quality standards. And the spirit is, we will be performing this analysis as if we were asking our own PhD students to compare our method to a published paper. And we would not accept an answer like, I tried for 10 minutes and this didn't work, so I gave up. Really, we pushed really hard sometimes to make this method work. We also analyze trends, and our third goal is also to encourage the sharing of code, and mostly via a community website. And to do that, we analyzed 374 papers, and out of all these papers, we ran 151 codes, or at least attempted to do so. Now, for the state of the art, there's a reproducibility crisis that has been coined in experimental sciences and initially in psychology and social sciences, where replication rates of 36% to like 79% have been estimated. And there are wide disparities across fields between engineering and physics and so on. And closer to our field is the problem of reproducibility in computational sciences, where it involves code. There is a paper in hydrology that found that the lack of code documentation is the biggest problem when we try to reproduce results. There is an analysis of over 400 Ishkai and AAAI papers in artificial intelligence that found that 6% of them shared code. In image processing, there is a paper about transaction and image processing papers that found that giving away code doubles the number of citations. There's no really study on computer graphics about reproducibility, and that's exactly what we wanted to do. There are reproducibility and replicability efforts. Mostly there's some in machine learning and pattern recognition. In computer graphics, there is a journal that is dedicated to that, the IPOL journal, where you can publish an implementation of some algorithm. So that's also the Journal of Computer Graphics Techniques that is closely focused to implementations. And importantly, there's a Graphics Replicability Stamp Initiative that awards reproducibility labels to reproducible papers, and it's coupled with journals like Transactions and Graphics, for example. So you can apply for that. In other domains, there are artifacts evaluation committees, notably in programming languages. What's interesting here is that they provide some incentive to be reproducible. They give additional presentation time for people that give code, or an extra page in the conference proceedings. So it's an interesting way to see it. There are other technical initiatives like websites that list codes, and there is here a big issue that is the long-term storage of code. Instead of focusing on storing code for the next 5 years, for example, the GitHub archive program focused on long-term archival of code for the next 1,000 years. There's Software Heritage as well that is doing something similar. So our approach is that we took all these papers from SIGGRAPH and reported factual information like ACM keywords, paper URL, and so on. Whether there is code, there is documentation. If there is no code, maybe there is an algorithm in the paper that easily allows to reproduce the method. The type of software, sometimes there's no code, but there is a binary, and that is still useful when we want to compare our approach to others. The kind of license, the dependencies, some impact metrics. We also categorized papers into a few categories, which are more practical than the ACM keywords. Mostly also we documented how to make the code run and the time we spent making it run. For example, here we can see a documentation of how to make one of the code runs. It's quite exhaustive and there are many steps. It was not trivial. And that's a big contribution of our paper. We give away these instructions. We also report subjective assessment in terms of score. Notably, there's the algorithm reproducibility score, which means that if there is no code, but there is a very short self-contained maybe algorithm or shader in the paper, maybe it's not directly code, but still useful because it's almost like a code. And we have also the code replicability score, which, for example, if you have a script that produces all the results in the paper, of course, you would get a 5. But even if you don't have the input data, if it gives something that is reasonable, given, for example, different input data, you could still get a 5. Now, our results, we provide some data on paper availability and code availability. Out of 374 papers, notably, we have 133 with code and 18 with binary. 60 of them do not have license information, and 11 do not have documentations nor instruction at all. Interestingly, the trend is really increasing over time. In 2014, there were less than 30% of papers with code, and in 2018, more than 50%. It's also highly dependent on the topic. In image and geometry, we can see that more people tend to share code than in animation or fabrication. The thing is that it's also a limitation to our approach. In fabrication, there are many contributions that do not rely on code, that rely directly on constructing things. We also found that giving away the code increases the number of citations by 55% in the long term for 2014 papers. So it provides an incentive as well to do it. Surprisingly, we did not find an impact of the year on the replicability score. It just means that for older papers, it took more time and it took more effort to run the code, but they were as replicable as recent papers. Also, we had to modify more than half of the code to make them work, and 20 of these codes were deemed hard to fix, and for 27 of them, it took more than 100 minutes. And it could even have taken days to fix them. And there is an effect of whether the authors are all from the academia or whether they include industrial partners. And it's an issue because when I develop a method and want to compare to existing approaches, it should not matter who the authors are. We identified common issues, notably due to dependencies. For example, if you use TensorFlow 1.4, it requires you to downgrade your CUDA drivers to version 8, which is not even supported by recent graphics cards. Python 2.7 is not even maintained as of January 1st this year. Cafe, which is an older neural networks library, is not maintained anymore. There are important syntax changes in PyTorch and Qt. Sometimes programs are shipped with precompiled libraries for outdated compilers. And all of that is really important, notably in deep learning, where this area is expanding and evolving very fast. And libraries are also expanding very fast. Sometimes pre-trained neural networks were not given, only the raw network. And the important issue is that it can take days or maybe weeks to retrain a neural network. The datasets to train them can be huge. We even had a case where we could not extract the dataset itself. And sometimes there's also the lack of instruction to run the program. There's no default parameter. The output is undocumented. Sometimes it's even just raw numbers that are displayed on screen. The file type of the output sometimes is undocumented as well. And occasionally there are even bugs in the program. We will now make a short demo of our website. So here is our website, where we can have a brief overview of some statistics on the papers and reviews. Clicking on the data, you have access to the reviews themselves, where you can sort by scores, or you can filter by title or author name or paper's year. Clicking on a given paper, like this one, for example, we can get access to the review itself. So here it's a quite long review to make the code run. And you can comment if you have some tips. If you're the author of the paper, you can also comment to give further tips, to say that the code has improved, for example, or to reply to some misunderstandings. If the code has changed in the meantime, you can even submit a new review of the same paper. You click on plus and it says that you can contribute by following some instructions. The instructions consist in saying that you have a JSON file that you need to fill. So these are the different fields that you need to fill: the title, DOI, and so on. In the case a review has already been done for this paper, then you can just update these fields. And once you have edited your JSON file, you do a pull request to this GitHub project here. You identified on which folder it should go. So it's a SIGGRAPH 2014 paper in that case. You save under the correct DOI.json name. And then you do a pull request and it will automatically update once it's approved the website.
And you can also perform a new review for new papers. For example, we started doing reviews for SIGGRAPH 2019 papers. So you can also put your files there.
A limitation to our approach is that we could not really assess some hardware papers because they required Hall sensor, microcontrollers, spatial light modulators, and so on. And this is devices that we do not have. It's also an assessment at the current time. Maybe the code that we have evaluated this year will not run next year due to evolved libraries, for example, or hardware. And maybe, and hopefully, authors or some authors will fix their code so that they run next year. We also cannot propose a perfect solution for the dependencies issues. There are some solutions based on virtualization, Docker, Anaconda, or Nix, but nothing is perfect. But we still have recommendations for the authors to avoid libraries when possible, or large libraries. For example, if it's just to load an image file only, you do not need to integrate OpenCV, maybe just STV image will work. But at least you should describe the library versions that you're using when you use them, or even ship libraries when it's possible. You should document your code, provide data, and pre-train neural networks. For program shares, we suggest to set a later, maybe a week later, deadline for the code for people to have time to clean their code and submit it and really focus on the code. And we'd also like them to communicate about replicability and how important it is to share code. For publishers, we would like them to identify the code separately from the supplementary materials. It's really an important thing for a paper to share the code and to have it identified as it. And maybe to rely on long-term code storage, such as software heritage, for example, to store this code. Thank you for your attention.